feather from a phoenix, and it seldom gives me grief. First, it shimmers in the sunlight, then it changes like a leaf. Turns from violet into silver, then from silver into gold, then igniting into fire, into ashes, gray and cold. Then, I sweep it all together, and I make a little pile, and I rearrange my papers, and I wait a little while, till it rises from the ashes, and I take it up again, and continue writing stories with my phoenix feather pen. English, you glamorous fish, you are all that a poet could wish. As messy as mud pies, as massive as booms, a tongue for the tuneful, a language for limbs. You've got platefuls of puns and such synonym stacks. You are filling up ears with clicks, hiccups, and cracks. You're a borrower, a lender, ever tender to the times, generous to paradox and paradigms and rhymes. You have grown, you have aged, you have changed as we changed, and I'm grateful for all that you are. Now this next poem is something that, at the time of writing, I was not working in a library yet, and so now I am. I would like to add that I do not recommend, this is not a recommended action that's hypothesized in this poem, and I would actually strongly encourage no one to consider this, but it was, it's called Night in the Library. What would happen if we happened to remain? When the regular frequenters make a train for the door? When the shadows lengthen long among the chatter and the throng at the circulation desk? Beep, 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 and all the rest. When everything is checked out and powered down, if we were stealthy and we stayed, if we move straight to a corner and we stayed out of sight to remain in the silence of the woods, overlooked in the shelter of the shallows, mischievous and as merry as the elves. And if we stashed a pack of snacks and things to bring along for the lingering, dried fruit, check, beef jerky, check, flashlights and batteries, check, and check. What then in the den of the lions and their lairs, once we're locked in the paper dragon's lair? Shall we feast on the pages like the bookworms that we are, making castles with shelves and comfy chairs? Would they find us in the morning in a large print paper nest, open volumes for our pillows, like a couple armadillos sleeping snugly on an open treasure chest? So this one is called Archaeology and Archives. Archaeologists unearth the past, while archivists lay down the dead. In a conversation built to last, the test of time was slow decay. In ages old, the pages fold and wait to be coming back, revealing long-forgotten gold of a different time and track. Waking up the mysteries, laying down the clues, dusting off the libraries that were bound and shelved brand new. Alexandrian cartography, papyrus pictographs. The archivist records a joke, and the digger-upper laughs. So when I shelve the records of this present day and age, I wonder who I'm talking to through the ever-living page. This was called Shelf Life. I think I should like to reside on a shelf and sleep in a matchbox at night, with knickknacks and trinkets the size of myself and no tests or papers to write. For company, I would keep porcelain friends and the bust of some infamous head. I would write with voluminous feathery pens, and the ravens would bring me my bread. I would crack open covers of large printed books to see if their stories unlock. I would brush off the dust from my bishops and rooks, and I'd sleep to the tick of the clock. Are you ever afraid that you've run out of words, that the poems you've made have let loose all the birds, and they'll never return to their cage? That your fat golden goose has produced its last egg, that your mouth is no use and your tongue is a rag, just an empty old stage of the page? It's called A Candle, and it's alternatively titled That Which Frightens My Dentist. There is a candle standing in the darkness of my throat, and it's grinning, and it's glinting, and it's gleaming as it glows. The flame, it flickers, flickers in the wake of every breath. Yes, the flame, it dances, dances, but it never meets its death. The flame attacks the wax beneath its fascinating form, wax that softens into honey as it welcomes in the warmth. It is dripping, pooling, cooling on the surface of my tongue, and I taste it in my molars, and I taste it in my lungs. And I must be very careful if I ever try to speak, that I do not set on fire every object.